killed by Topsy. Elephant resented Blount's conduct and broke every bone in his body. James Fielding Blount, 39 years old, of Fort Wayne, Indiana, was killed at 5 a.m. today by one of the elephants in the Menagerie of Forepaugh and Sells Brother Circus now showing in Brooklyn. Blount had a small water glass in his hand and was flashing it before an elephant named Topsy. Known to be playful, but Topsy did not seem to relish the sport. Before Blount could realize her temper, Topsy threw her trunk around him, lifted him in the air, and with awful force slammed him to the ground several times, breaking every bone in his body and beating his brains out. While this article only details one of several accounts of this incident, the other accounts suggest that it was a bottle of whiskey being offered to Topsy, and that the teasing continued on with Blount throwing sand in the elephant's face and burning her extremely sensitive trunk with a lit cigar. While the death of Blount didn't seal Topsy's fate, it was one of a series of misbehaviors that would lead to her downfall, ultimately resulting in her being executed by electrocution, which was turned into a public spectacle. I've actually done an entire segment on Topsy's life. Please check out my 5 Fascinating Animals video to learn more. Link in the description. This, the last legal hanging in Arkansas. Arthur Tillman, 22, convicted of the murder of Amanda Stevens at Delaware, Arkansas, March last, was hanged in the jail yard here today. Tillman maintained his innocence to the last. He is the last person to be legally executed by hanging in Arkansas, as electrocution will be used in the future. It's hard to say what sticks out more, the article's casualness for execution, or that it comes across as if electrocuting someone to death is so innovative. Texas jealousies will make Kennedy's visit rough. President Kennedy's 2-day swing through Texas, beginning today, has suddenly developed a political coloration which suggests that he is about to embark on the most tricky egg-walking expedition of his career. This is because Texas Democrats have begun hurling insults at each other over the social and political arrangements for the visit of the president and his wife. All this at the very time that it was hoped that Kennedy could personally apply a healing hand to Texas party wounds so that there would be a semblance, at least, of unity in the 1964 campaign. The next day, Friday, November 22nd, 1963, Kennedy would be assassinated. This article, which includes statements about how Kennedy's visit to Texas was going to be rough, and that he was embarking on the most tricky egg-walking expedition of his career, plus its suggestion for the Texas Democratic Party to make Kennedy's visit a happy one, ends up being quite an unsettling piece, knowing it was one of the last articles to be written while he was alive. Let's shake up the formula with a TV guide listing. This schedule of TV programs was published on Sunday, July 14th, 1974, for what was to air that upcoming Tuesday, July 16th. Between those 2 days, however, a tragedy would occur. On this TV guide, at 9:30 on Channel 40, Suncoast Digest with Christine Chubbuck would take place. However, this episode would never air because on the previous day's episode of Suncoast Digest, Chubbuck proceeded to draw a .38 caliber Smith & Wesson Model 36 revolver and shot herself. Chubbuck was the earliest suicide to appear during a live television broadcast, but she wouldn't be the last. John Lennon deserves our respect. No one understood why JL dropped a terrific career to stay home with the baby. After all, there are babysitters and day schools, and JL had the money to afford both. Nonetheless, JL chose to cook and coo full-time for little Sean.
I sent Sean to kindergarten. When I realized I was sending him there to get rid of him, I let him come home. If I don't give him attention at 5, then I'm gonna have to give him double doses of it in his teenage years. It's owed. I'm a rich housewife, but it still involves caring.
JL said, somewhat annoyed. Paycheck people said nice things about JL's devotion, but then they asked, when are you really going to do something important? When a former coworker dropped in, JL said,
look, do you mind ringing first? I've just had a hard day with the baby. I'm worn out and you're walking in with the damn guitar.
Thus, John Lennon, self-proclaimed housewife, bounced Paul McCartney out of his New York apartment. Lennon, who needn't worry about losing seniority on the job, has now returned to recording. He told Newsweek recently,
I'll be 40 and Sean will be 5, and I can afford to say, Daddy does something else as well.
Instead of giving honorees money, legislative support, and a prevailing sense of being respected and appreciated 365 days, we give a flash of recognition and forget them until next year. It is hard to forget a rock and roll model like John Lennon. His life, in many ways, may be a bit too rarefied for the rest of us, but he asked something every family should have 52 weeks a year. True respect for people whose work is caring. So, John Lennon, I want to shake your hand. This article, which praised Lennon for his career decisions and details him as a very happy family man, all becomes a big what if because Lennon was shot and killed the following day. Gay deaths linked to mysterious syndrome, an outbreak of deadly disease among homosexual men, which has turned usually harmless infections into killers, has been linked to a mysterious breakdown in the body's disease-fighting system. The still unnamed syndrome has been reported in 180 people in 15 states in the last 18 months, 92% of them homosexual men. So far, say federal officials, 75 patients have died. It's an extraordinary business and really quite frightening because nobody knows the cause, said Dr. Frederick P. Segal, an immunologist who headed a recent study of the problem at Mount Sinai Medical Center in New York City. It's an extraordinary event because it's a new immunodeficiency disease. I think it's a public health hazard. Doctors are not sure what is turning off the anti-infection system of homosexuals and making them unusually vulnerable to pneumocystis carini pneumonia, a rare skin cancer called Kaposi sarcoma, and severe cases of herpes simplex virus infections. The three diseases are rarely fatal in the general population, but this year a sudden increase in fatalities was noticed, and in July the Federal Centers for Disease Control reported that of 152 cases they had analyzed, more than half the pneumonia victims and 20% of those with Kaposi sarcoma died. While we've come such a long way with combating the AIDS epidemic, it's depressing to look at it from a time when not only did nobody know, one, what the virus was, but two, how many lives the virus would eventually take. Dwyer won't quit? Oust him. Under Pennsylvania law, no convicted criminal can serve as state treasurer. Bud Dwyer was convicted last month of accepting a $300,000 bribe. The law says that when he is sentenced on January 23rd, he can no longer serve as treasurer and must resign. But Dwyer has decided the law doesn't apply to him. He says he is going to remain treasurer as long as he likes. Well, this is an insult to everyone. Everyone should write or call their state representative and tell him or her to impeach Bud Dwyer if he doesn't resign by Friday. We don't need a convicted criminal running our state's treasury from jail. Little did anyone know that contacting their state representative or taking other steps to impeach Dwyer wouldn't be necessary. The following day, Dwyer held a press conference in which he proclaimed his innocence and made it clear that he had no intention of resigning, even if that meant him dying in office. For all at the press conference to see, including 5 news cameras, Dwyer revealed a gun from a manila envelope. The room quickly erupted into a panic. People immediately began to plead with him. Dwyer advised anyone who wouldn't be able to handle what was about to happen, leave. He intended to continue with the remainder of his speech. However, because things had suddenly become chaotic at the presence of him wielding the gun, Dwyer, without hesitation, opened his mouth and widened his eyes, firing a shot through the roof of his mouth, instantly collapsing on the floor. A second gun was later found strapped to his ankle, a backup. In case the other gun had malfunctioned, Dwyer could still go through with his plan. While the graphic footage is easily found on the internet, I instead encourage you to check out James Dershberger's Honest Man, a fascinating documentary about Dwyer's suicide and what led up to it. I wish I would've met you.